the first time ever on location with our next guest on this show. We're going to talk to him about his musical experience, what he's been up to lately. All-around great guy, phenomenal musician, phenomenal guitarist. We have Ryan Hommel on the show today, and he's going to start us off with a song here, and he's going to play for us a song for me.
Yeah.
Play, Ryan.
I'm so damn tired of writing songs for you. I just had to write a song for me. And I'm not sure if it's right or wrong or blind. So allow me to explain my selfish side. I've been drinking, I've been thinking about all those wasted I love yous. Thought that I was paying dues. Love is not a bought thing. It's not to write a stupid song to make it better thing. I'm so damn tired of writing songs for you. I just had to write a song for me. And I'm not sure if it's right or wrong or blind. So allow me to explain my selfish side. That you can't stop me, you can't save me from January's in Bailey's, chasing all the girls I please. Surely you've got better things, like kissing the boy who works the spa in Sarasota Springs. I'm so damn tired of writing songs for you. So why'd it take me so damn long to see? Those songs for you really weren't yours. Just a quiet way to cope when you were slamming all of my open doors. I'm so damn tired of writing songs for you. I just had to write a song for me. And I'm not sure if it's right or wrong or blind. So allow me to explain my selfish side. My selfish side.
All right, thanks, Ryan, and thanks
Thank
for being
you.
On the show.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for letting us into your home.
Thanks for coming.
Out here in Central Mass, and we're excited to have you back on the program. We got, this is a kind of a redo, if you will, of a show, but we tried this once before and didn't exactly, on my air, it didn't work out, but now we're here and we're getting it all said and done. So
fun. This is fun.
So let's jump right into it. Why don't you tell us kind of a little bit about your background, when you started playing music, who are your influences, when did you make the decision to make this your career?
I started playing guitar when I was maybe about 4 or 5, and the biggest thing was really, I think, the fact that my parents are both musical. My dad's a great guitar player. My mom is a writer. She's an author, but along with that, when I was a kid, she was writing children's music, and she plays piano and guitar and sings. And the other thing is that when I was a toddler, maybe I was 3 or so, the postage stamp, the Elvis postage stamp, came out, and it's the one where he's sort of like gripping the mic, really cool, and that sort of came along with this big push of more radio play for Elvis on like all the radio stations, like even the heavy metal station, the hip hop stations were playing Elvis, and a bunch of documentaries about his life and made for TV movies sort of loosely based around his life. And I was enamored. It was like a rock star, and he stood for something so clear. And the music that went along with it just really really perked me up. Like, I really loved that music, and along with that came my interest, you know, Buddy Holly, and then it went to the R&B place with Stevie Wonder, and I don't know that it was ever a decision to make it a career. It just sort of was something that always was obvious to me that I was just going to keep doing it, and try to keep getting better.
Was there a moment for you when, you know, whether it was a performance or the, you know, a time practicing, that you were kind of like, this, I love this, this is it, this is what I want to do, I want to pursue it? Like, was there any one moment that you had that kind of realization?
There was a moment when I was 10, and my mom and I went out to go see my guitar teacher at the time, a fantastic and extremely influential person in my life, a guy named John Sheldon, who lives in the area here. We went to go see his band play, and they were playing in a bar in Northampton, I think, and he invited me up on stage, and he threw me a baritone guitar, which is just sort of like a longer version, sort of like a cross between a bass and a guitar. And the strings are six strings, but they're much heavier because they're lower. And I'd never played a baritone guitar before, and I was 10, so my fingers were, you know, totally getting a workout.
Right.
And I just remember feeling like, sort of despite the difficult instrument situation and everything, just how glorious it felt to just play music with a bunch of other amazing musicians, get my butt kicked, you know, and do it all in front of people who seemed like they were having a good time because of it.
Right.
Or along with us. And I sort of, you know, looking back on it, I think it was a hotel bar, and it was, at that point, it was all smoke-filled and totally unglamorous. But to me, 10 years old is my first experience with that kind of situation. I think I looked at my mom and just said, I could do this every day, you know?
Yeah, that one moment.
That was totally a moment for me, and I think about that a lot. And I do it every day now.
That's awesome.
I feel lucky for it.
That's great.
Yeah.
So we're going to jump into another song here, as we're joined on the set here by Mr. Drubal, in the house here again of Ryan Hommel. And you're going to play for us Reds and Yellows.
Absolutely. This is a song that that is just been recorded by my really good friend and roommate, Mark Seedorf, whose dog that is. And it'll be on an upcoming record that we're going to talk about in just a minute. But this song is called Reds and Yellows. Yeah. Back and we'll be falling, you will be all I have. The last week of summer don't feel like a bummer, cause I know I love the colors and the times that we'll share together. Pointing at the reds and yellows, you make me better than the real leather jackets on the head. Jackets on the handsome fellow. It's easy getting stuck in the mud, in the muck, when all it ever does is rain. We can take pleasure in all of the weather and love it as the seasons change. Together, pointing at the reds and yellows, you make me better than the real leather jackets on the handsome fellows. The leather jackets on the handsome fellows, yeah. You make it easy like the river. Girl, you tease me like a sliver of the moon now. Making me better
much.
Yeah.
Do you own a leather jacket?
I do. I own my my dad's old Shot Brothers motorcycle riding jacket, and I've never ridden a motorcycle. But I wear it, man. It's a nice jacket.
Awesome. So, you know, talking about songwriting a bit, where is it that you draw your inspiration from? Do you start with words? Do you start with the guitar melody? Or, you know, what does it look like when you're putting a song together?
Nothing is absolute in that world for me. And many of the other writers that I would consider, you know, strong inspirations or close friends, I've never really heard of anybody who always starts with one thing or the other. And I think that's because, at least in my experience, every song sort of requires its own attention and is going to be a bit different. It feels a lot like piecing something together and picking up the pieces. And again, that's sort of something that I've heard the process, the songwriting process, described in the same way by other writers as well. And that genuinely is what it feels like to me, is that it's sort of, as a writer, you really, yes, it's writing, physically you're writing, but there's so much to do with trying to spin things around, and it's like putting together a puzzle. Like, you sort of find the corner pieces, and then you kind of got to fill it in.
Right.
And but those pieces already exist in the world, and to believe that I am fabricating them, just kind of manufacturing them out of thin air, or from my life experiences, I don't think really to give enough credit to the world around me, you know?
Right.
And it makes it daunting when you're staring at a blank page, right, and nothing is coming to you.
Now, are you the type that, you know, will write things down at any time, you know, grab a napkin from a place and write down some words, or are you the type that will sit down and say, I'm going to get after songwriting and make it happen that way?
A bit of both. I mean, if I don't sit down and really make myself do it, sometimes it just doesn't happen. You know, some songs, inspiration strikes and everything falls together and the puzzle is very obvious. And then other times, it's difficult and it requires a lot of work. And I mean, something has to feel like work. I mean, I get to play guitar and sing for a living. You know, I get to make music for a living and do it every day. So, you know, the fact that writing sometimes doesn't come easy is no complaint, but it's just the truth. And yeah, I do. I have a lot of, like, on my phone, you know, the voice memos application that is
right,
just always overflowing. And
right,
I sort of try and just let it all hang out on there and pieces in a little notebook and then bring it together later on, try and make sense of it all. And
sure,
even cross-pollinate, like, oh, I thought that was going to be for this song, and maybe they all kind of blend into one.
Sure.
Yeah.
Now, switching gears a little bit here, as Jubal joins
Jubal
us back on set. You know, you just got off a run touring with Edwin McCain,
mm-hmm,
recently had a show last night, actually, with the Sweetback Sisters.
Yep.
You've had a lot of different opportunities to kind of play a bunch. But you're also working on some new projects as well, and you have a record that you're producing right now that will come. And why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so that's the record. The record is called The Optical Shop, and the record actually started out as a band called The Optical Shop, which was myself and Mark Seedorf on the bass, owner of this lovely dog Jubal and roommate here, and Colin Jalbert on the drums. And we just love playing music together, and I sort of brought a batch of songs to Colin and Mark because we were in a room and playing music together, and it just felt so right, and we just decided, okay, let's do this again, and let's try playing my music. And that was sort of the model for the band, of like I would kind of bring songs to the table and we'd arrange them together. And so this record that's coming out, it's mainly the three of us, in addition to some other wonderful musicians from sort of the Pioneer Valley area here in Massachusetts, you know, Northampton area. And what's happened along the way is that the band has just sort of, I mean, I guess just honestly, being in a band is hard. You know, being in a band is really hard. And being in a new band with two other incredibly talented musicians who are busier than I am, for sure, playing, touring. Mark is engineering and producing records for other bands in the area. Touring, playing bass and singing with Seth Gleer. Colin, the drummer, has his own band called Mammal Dap, and they're like an electronic hip-hop dance band, and they're awesome, very successful, and they just put out their first record, their first full-length record. Everyone's like, it's all good, you know, and we're all doing really fun stuff, but it ended up not being a viable reality to sure. tour as a band right now. And alongside that, I've been touring, like you said, just got off the road opening for Edwin McCain for a couple weeks, just solo, just me and a guitar. And I wasn't sure if I was going to like that because I'd never done it before, you know, an extended period of time. And my realizing that I actually really love doing that, I love playing solo, and I love delivering the songs that way, has spurred this record to be a solo record, and we're calling it The Optical Shop, and it has so much just love and genuine passion for playing together, and it really, I'm really excited because it does exactly what I think a record should do. It's a time capsule. It's preserving a moment in time that we can never recreate.
That's great. So you've also had a lot of other sideman opportunities, playing with, you know, the likes of Heather Maloney, Stephen Kellogg, the Sweetback Sisters, Haley Reardon. You've been seen on many different stages with many different people. Can you talk about those experiences? Because it's taken you a lot of different places.
It sure has. I'm blown away by it myself. And it started, that sideman world for me, playing other people's music for a living, that started with Seth Gleer. And we both grew up in Western Massachusetts, and we met when we were 13 or 14 in that area, and immediately just totally were enamored with one another. I was sort of the, you know, early high school, I was in my Stevie Ray Vaughan phase, so I was playing lots of blues guitar, playing in Springfield bars with whoever would sort of let me, you know, the older than me people,
right.
which was everybody when you're 14 and playing guitar. And I was totally blown away by Seth's ability to write a song at 13 that would move an entire room full of people at 13. I just, at any age, it's impressive, but man, like to be emotionally intelligent at that age, on that level, just, I wasn't sure. I don't even know if I could have articulated it then, but I sure can now. And actually, this is a fun picture of the two of us from back in the day. It's like our second headlining show ever at the Iron Horse. I think I was 16 and he was 15 there. Maybe he wouldn't want me to show you that picture because we both changed a lot since then. But you know, I continue to be blown away by Seth, but I've gone off topic. Basically, it all started there for me, and I think he learned how to be a band leader, and I learned how to be a sideman, support a song and support a bunch of different songs every night in hopes that rather than detract and distract from them, I would help to sharpen the message. And we learned how to do that in our own sort of, he on his side of the stage and me on my side of the stage. He on his side of the car, me on my side of the car. You know, we learned how to do that together. And I really became passionate about that specific way of playing music.
Yeah.
And I still am. I pride myself in the work that I'm able to do. And I've learned a lot of lessons along the way. When I first started playing with Stephen Kellogg, for instance, he has such an amazing wide catalog of music, you know, it's
right.
Just, he writes so much, and every song, again, always deserves its own approach, whether you're talking about writing or learning and playing, and no two songs will ever really, will ever sort of get across in the same way from the sideman perspective,
right.
So to support, you know, 70 songs or so is to just, that's a big undertaking. And I came in kind of green the first time we played together, and totally got my butt kicked, you know, by and we found our way together, and I've learned a lot from Steven along the way. And so every kind of step has shown me how to sharpen the tools in order to sharpen the stories that I'm using them for.
Sure. Now what's that like when you're meeting with Steven Keller, and it's like, here's all my, I can't imagine it's here's learn 20, it's more of a learn them all, let's go on tour type thing.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I think as an artist, you don't ever want someone new, someone's inability, or, you know, someone's lack of experience with your music to dictate how your shows are going to go. Why should it? You know, why should the weakest link in the chain get to be like, well, can we do the same set every night because I don't know your other songs? It's
right.
Just if someone asks you to do something and they're paying you to do it and they're standing behind you and they're helping you, you just have to do it.
Right.
And so what's it like? It's hard. It's hard just mentally to hold it all together. And I was just talking with a really, really good friend of mine and a previous bandmate of mine in Steven's band, Travis McNabb, a drummer. And he was describing his experience recently learning songs for a new artist. And he said, you know, it's like, no matter how much homework you do, you're still going to be a deer in headlights in the show. You know, like you work and then you work harder and then you do more work because you do as much as you can and then twice that much.
Right.
And then no matter what happens, the first couple of shows, you're just still going to be like, oh my God, what am I? God, it's just, you get to engage so fully mentally. And, you know, but I think if you approach it with the sort of compassion that it deserves, you'll find your way to the best place, you know. And it, you know, playing with Steven certainly did for me. I learned a lot, but I definitely had to learn even deeper how to learn someone's music.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna hear another one of your songs right now.
Yes.
You're gonna play for us, If I Wanted To.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is also going to be on the Optical Shop record. One goes out to Jubal. I watched you pull out of the driveway like nothing ever happened. You should have seen the look on my face as if your car seat wasn't fastened. Buckle up for the long strange ride. It goes by fast like highway signs. You wonder if I'd slow you down. I couldn't if I wanted to. Just as spring leaps from the winter, you leapt straight out of my arms. Now the scary thing to figure is letting go could do no harm. But for 18 years we had a good run, and I've kept you safe. But now you're gone and you wonder if I'd hold you back. I couldn't if I wanted to. I breathe deeply every morning. It hurts to miss you every day. I got no reason to be mourning, though I wish you were around to hear me say that I would never hold you back. I couldn't if I wanted to. Up when I want to, no alarm set for the bus. You took a table in my sofa for the next guy that you'll trust. You'll be dressed in white down the road as I watch you take his hand to hold. And you wonder if I'd hold you back. I couldn't if I wanted to. I would never hold you back. I couldn't if I wanted to.
All right, another lovely song here by Ryan Hommel. We're Thank getting you. Down to the end of our program. I just got a few quick questions left, and then sure. we'll roll into, we'll get one more song from you before we depart. So what would you say is your overall proudest moment or greatest accomplishment so far of your career?
One of the most memorable experiences, and this might dovetail into one of your other questions too, but was the time that Seth Glear and I got to go to the Grammys together. the record that we produced together, called The Next Right Thing, it was a couple albums ago now for Seth, was nominated for a Grammy in 2011 for the 2012 Grammys. And we were in Denver. We were just gotten to my cousin's house in the middle of the night, and we were zonked from our drive, and we were sitting on his couch in the basement watching Family Guy. I remember it so well, and his phone just started blowing up with tweets and texts and basically all just saying congratulations. And we had no idea what was going on, and he got a call from someone at his record label and said, you got nominated, officially nominated for a Grammy. Fast forward a few months, and there we were together, on the red carpet, which is not a place that I never really thought of myself as being in the same room as the people that you'd see on the... In fact, the funniest part about this, at least to me, is that the year before the Grammys that we went to, I watched the Grammys from a friend's house. Again, I was on tour. And it was the year that CeeLo Green had that big bird situation yeah. happening, and it was awesome. And I was but I saw that moment with CeeLo in the Big Bird costume, and I was like, am I even on the same planet? Am I even doing the same thing as these right. people? And it's not as for a lack of respect, it's immense respect, but I just here I am with I got my folk songs, and but then, the very next year. So I was proud of that, not for the red carpet portion as much as just the fact that, Seth and I did that together, we just kind of kept our head down and made our art and pushed really hard for it on the other end. And I'm just, that blows me away. Just extreme gratitude, and it was really a very humbling experience to listen to Alison Krauss win that Grammy, another Grammy.
Right, right.
But very humbling to be in the same category. And anyway,
that's awesome.
Yeah.
So we're gonna get one last song from you on our program here. There's gonna be some bonus materials if you head over to YouTube to catch the rest of the program. But you're gonna take us out with Krista.
Yeah, here's a song from the first EP. It's called Krista. Memphis by way of Boston. So glad I met you there. But you stuck out like a sore thumb, sugar plum, half a dozen feet tall, with ginger red hair. Running into you at a quarter to two was the best thing that I could not plan to do. Krista, can I kiss you on the swing set? And I missed you, always pouting, say you gotta go. Just hop into the right side of my sporty rental ride, and we can drive until you say we're home. Krista, you can go, but don't go alone. Whoa. walking through City Square. I saw you at the rendezvous. I caught a glimpse of us in the mirror. Man, what a pretty pair. But my heart can't handle your skin so fair. Dreaming every day since we parted ways of the things we do and just what I'd say. Oh, Krista, can I kiss you on the swing set in the mist? You always pout and say you gotta go. Just hop into the right side of my sporty rental ride and we can drive until you say we're home. Krista, you can go, but don't go alone. Life's too short to be sleeping on a thing like this. Krista, give me a call if after all it's me you miss. Then Krista, I'll kiss you on the swing set in the mist. Should you decide that you don't have to go, I just hop into the right side of my sporty rental ride and we can drive until you say that we're home. Krista, time will show, but time might move real slow. Krista, you can go, but don't go alone. Awesome,
man. Some fantastic finger picking.
Thanks.
If you're with us here, we're on the bonus material.
We've entered bonus the, OT.
On the YouTube channel for RCTV. So, you know, just out of my curiosity, I'm, as you're going to perform, what's do you have like a process that you go through as far as like, you know, to get yourself hyped up or, you know, when you're going, is it different when you're going from a solo performance or if you're going, you know, if you're backing someone in a band or?
Yeah, it's super different. Yeah, it couldn't be more different, in fact. And that that is something that takes constant awareness for me. For instance, after the Edwin McCain run, opening for Edwin for a couple of weeks, solo, just, as Edwin calls it, just caveman in it up there, you know, with, just like strumming chords and singing songs, I went straight into playing guitar, electric guitar, for the Sweetback Sisters, which is a fantastic country band with a just another amazing catalog of original country music. And my job in that band is to play fast, you know, to play precise, really. I mean, it's not as much fast as it's high energy, you know, and it's a lot of guitar playing, a lot of really intense guitar playing. And I love doing that, but it just takes some attention. It takes a day for me to practice and get the chops back up. I mean, really, every time I sit down to do it after having not played with them for a while, I need to just get back in the
right action
there. Yeah,
I can imagine. It's totally two totally different mindsets as you're trying to get in for it.
Yeah, yeah, but it's exciting. That's what keeps it. That's what keeps it light, and that's what keeps it kind of in motion the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Now, as you're looking forward towards the summer here, summer of 2015 coming up, what are things you're looking forward to, things that you have on the horizon?
I'm looking forward to playing the Green River Festival this year. I've played it before with the Sweetback Sisters and with Heather Maloney and with Seth Glear. I'll be playing solo this time. In fact, I'll be on the same day, which is Saturday, July 11th, I'll be playing on the same stage, the same day as Haley Reardon, who's another fantastic singer-songwriter from Massachusetts, and I've been playing some duo with her lately. So I'll probably play a few songs with her and be a big family event, but I mean, the Green River Festival is, if any of you out there haven't been, or if any of you have, you know what I'm talking about. And if you haven't, you should absolutely come and join us and hang out this year. It's in Greenfield, Massachusetts, and just balloon rides and 3 days of amazing music. I'm so looking forward to it.
Can't beat that, right?
Yeah.
One of the things that I, on your website, ryanhommel.com,
mm-hmm.
you have a section of your website that's devoted entirely to coffee and coffee suggestions.
Yes, I do.
Can you just talk a little bit about that?
I love coffee. I love coffee. I kind of decided to do that. It was first started as a personal list, you know, because I wanted to keep better track of all the coffee that was my sort of my favorite spots in every town or city that I would go to along the way of these tours. And you know, I want to go back to the spots that I loved, but I also want to try new spots. So it was just kind of like managing a list. And then I thought, wow, wouldn't this be neat on the website? And maybe people can kind of chime in, because leave it to the locals to tell me where to go, you know, like the best spot that's not on Yelp or the, you know, that you can't find on the main drag or whatever in town. And I found a lot of great places that way. And it's just basically a little form on my website that says, like, you know, it goes to my email address and just suggests your favorite coffee shop in your town or a town that you've been to. And I really do just enjoy, that's sort of like, you kind of have to make your own fun, not that playing music every day isn't enough fun, but in the daytime it's a lot of hurry up and wait, and there can be long strides of time where you're just sort of left up to your own whatever. And it's really fun to seek out, you know, new coffee. It's just become a big hobby of mine.
Well, and a unique way to interact with fans as well.
Yeah, it is.
Give them that, the access.
It is. It totally is.
That's great.
Yeah.
The last question I have for you, and I know we've talked about this a little bit before, but one of my favorite instruments is the pedal steel.
Yeah.
And that's an instrument that you play. Can you talk about kind of how that came to be? Because it's not an instrument that you can just find lying around anywhere. It's kind of one of those ones you have to seek out and then really practice up on.
Yeah. The pedal steel came into the picture for me, again, with Seth Glear. We had a fantastic Massachusetts native musician, Charlie Rose, who you might have known from everybody. He plays with everybody. He's incredible. But he plays banjo in a wonderful band called Barnstar.
Mark Arelli and Zach Hickman.
And the Armadings. Yep, exactly. And so Charlie, in addition to playing fantastic guitar, banjo, cello, he plays pedal steel. And I mean, he plays pedal steel the way that old guys who only play pedal steel and have played it for their whole lives play pedal steel. He's just a wizard and has an incredible touch. And so he played on a song on the Next Right Thing record with Seth and I. And then as we were getting ready to record our next record, which is called Things I Should Let You Know, we said, well, why don't we, you know, we were sort of like getting the budget together and the schedule together for the recording sessions. And he said, well, why don't you just play pedal steel on this record? I was like, yeah, why don't I? I mean, sure, I'd love to, but I've never really even touched one. So we came up with this plan. I went out and got a pedal steel with my advance from the record label and decided to just sort of jump in. And on tour, sort of the way that it worked, I was home. Those days that we were on tour, like, you know, so many weeks on end at a time, and we come home for a couple days. So I was home for a couple days, bought the instrument locally, brought it home, set it up, and then basically just left again for tour and left it home, because I had no business really bringing all that extra weight in the car when I wasn't going to play it at the show. Right. So then the next time I broke it out was at the recording session, and where I was supposed to play pedal steel parts on the record. And the whole tour before that, I was looking up online, like, you know, ways, like how to play it, looking at YouTube videos or reading about it and sort of practicing in the car, like thinking about playing it. And it's interesting because that's such a big part of practicing, whether it's pedal steel or otherwise, is envisioning it, getting your brain to actually fire out the same signals that it would if you were in front of the instrument.
Right.
And it comes in handy when time is tight and you're in the car a lot and you don't have access to the instrument. So I did that with steel. And I think that that helped me get to the place where I could at least know how to play a chord on it and know like what I was doing. So the first session was very long, and it took a few hours to just get the part down for the first song. But from there, that launched me headfirst into playing, and I just kind of started telling people that I play pedal steel way before I really had any business telling people that I was available to play pedal steel with them. But that spurred the calls, you know. I was playing with Heather Maloney, and I decided, okay, well, I'll take it on tour with her because her music works really well with that instrument. And even if I only play it on one song a night, it's worth setting it up. It's worth the extra weight in the car because I get the experience.
Right.
And then when Stephen Kellogg called me to play with him, he was used to playing with an amazing musician, Sam Getz, who's out in the Cleveland area, and he plays pedal steel and guitar like a monster. And so I said, well, okay, well, I can also play pedal steel. And again, just nightly experience. And that's really what it's been. It's been practicing on the road.
Gotcha. As I understand, you also, that first session, it was kind of, you were just going with things, and Seth was in the studio with you, just kind of looking
right.
at what you were doing, right?
Yeah, he was sitting pretty much as far away from me as you are, and we were in the sort of the live room of the recording studio, and it's what you'd probably imagine if you imagine a recording studio where there's glass window and a mixing board behind it, and the engineers on one side, and kind of rolling tape as we, you know, running the computer program
right.
that captures all the music onto the hard drive. And Seth and I are on the other side of that glass, and I'm behind the pedal steel. Here it is, and totally freaking out about just trying to get this to sound like music. And he's literally with a notepad writing down like which fret sort of the slide is above and which strings I'm picking. And he's like probably working harder than I am even, just trying to figure out every motion. Like whenever he would like something that I played, but I didn't play it really strong enough or it was a little out of tune or something, he'd write it down and he'd say, okay, 10th fret, you know, these strings or whatever. And, you know, like, and it's to do with like, you know, foot pedals manipulate the tuning of the instrument on the fly. So he'd say, you know, the A and B pedals. And I mean, it was, we were cracking up because of just how ridiculous it was. But that took, you know, again, the first song took a few hours, and then the next one maybe took an hour and a half. And on the other end of those sessions, although there was more editing involved to really get the part together the way that you hear on the record, and more editing than I'd like to admit. But I came out on the other end of that session knowing the basics of how to find my way on the instrument, and just kept practicing from there. And I still have a long way to go. Again, people spend their entire lives learning how to play the pedal steel.
Sure.
And sort of think that I could do it at all and also play any other instrument or focus on anything else is totally ridiculous. But I love playing the pedal steel, and I'll keep doing it.
Well, and I've seen you play it, and you do play it pretty well.
Oh,
so.
Thanks.
So we're gonna get one more song here before we
yeah absolutely
part, and it's one of my favorites of yours. We're gonna hear Sarah Irene.
Yeah, let's do it. Got the best things to say about a girl I've been seeing. Letting her insides, giving life new meaning. Oh yeah. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. I wouldn't trade her for another. If she asked, I wouldn't smother. Got an older brother and a doppelganger mother. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. Ooh, oh yeah. I can always tell she loves me too. She takes me out, she pulls me through. I would never leave beyond. you came on cue. She was walking me slow like a movie scene. She kicked a rock and watched it roll like the credits on a screen. It's not as much like a movie as it is like a dream when I wake up to a kiss from Sarah Irene. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. Oh, oh, oh. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene. I'm in love with a girl named Sarah Irene.